Threat actors are leveraging an expanded attack surface, putting a crucial industry under constant threat. Hi, I'm Sherrod DeGrippo, Director of Threat Intelligence Strategy at Microsoft. According to the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, more than 400 data breaches of private health information have taken place since the start of 2023. So, what makes healthcare uniquely susceptible? And how do you recover from a ransomware attack? We'll dive into all of this and so much more with a roundtable of threat intelligence and healthcare security experts. Then, we'll catch up with the team at UC San Diego Healthcare, who reveal how a collective industry approach can help us become more resilient. There is so much to get into. This is the Microsoft Threat Intelligence Briefing. Joining me via Microsoft Teams are Stella Agakian, Senior Security Research Manager, Jack Mott, Senior Security Researcher, Wayman Ho, Senior Security Research Manager, and Errol Weiss, Chief Security Officer of the Health ISAC. Let's start high level. Why is healthcare uniquely susceptible to ransomware attacks?
We've had a history of hospitals in this country being underfunded when it comes to cybersecurity. And we have to go back to the mid-1990s when medical records started to be moved to digital formats, electronic health records, and then the advent of the HIPAA regulations, which the focus for the IT organizations at that point was to keep those medical records private and not necessarily secure. There was this propensity now for organizations to pay ransoms because they were vulnerable, they weren't backing up their systems, they didn't have the people to keep those systems up to date, and when they got attacked, the IT systems in the hospitals went down and they were left with no choice. They couldn't restore from a backup and they had to pay the ransoms.
What has the industry seen and experienced as part of the healthcare ISAC that you manage?
Yeah, so I like to say that ISACs are like virtual neighborhood watch programs. And the whole idea is that if you have a break-in or if you have an incident, you share that information with your neighbors so that they can better protect their own houses. And it works the same in an ISAC. So when companies see new threats, new vulnerabilities, new incidents, they can share that information with others in the community as well. You know, 2024 has just been a horrific year when it comes to incidents inside the healthcare sector. We've had hundreds of ransomware events. We've had major ransomware events that have impacted pharmacies and hospitals all across the U.S., impacting patient care. And then since June, we've also seen three Russian ransomware attacks that impacted the healthcare supply chain. So they're not just attacking hospitals, they're attacking the supply chain. And these in turn are causing widespread outages in London, across the state of Florida, for example, and also across the U.S. when we have impacts that are stopping blood flow supplies, blood plasma, and other critical medical supplies.
Yeah, typically the clock is ticking much faster at these organizations. It's a fast-paced environment. They have small teams that are not fully staffed or fully resourced to deal with security incidents in addition to their daily jobs. So we usually see a much smaller response or difficult response to security incidents.
Speaking of those incidents, what's causing those? What are the tactics that these threat actors are using?
Oftentimes, actors are looking for their initial access vector, whether that's exploiting vulnerable appliances or software on a network, or, taking compromised credentials from a phishing attack. But from there, they just try and move through that network, gain positioning, where then they can deploy this ransomware, bypass security controls, and create a incident where they can demand payment for that ransom.
What happens when Microsoft identifies threat actor behavior like this in a customer organization?
Microsoft has a very narrow scope or edge visibility into Microsoft and Microsoft customers when it comes to things like identity and authentication. So usually when we see suspicious activity that we believe is related to an adversary or threat actor, we will go and try to notify the customer right away. This is not a sales pitch. We don't offer products or sell, and it's not tied to anything. It's just for us to inform the organization, hey, you may be having some issues. You may be targeted by an adversary. Please take a look at your logs and defend against it.
If your hospital experiences a ransomware attack, where does that recovery begin?
Recovery is generally going to start from a tactical mitigation or, stop the bleeding approach, as some call it. That could involve things like taking portions of the network offline to protect your most important assets while you begin recovery, or oftentimes taking back positive administrative control of your identity plane. The important thing to note about starting recovery is that it should be analysis-led recovery. So your recovery teams should be working hand-in-hand with the investigative teams to understand what needs to be recovered.
Let's go afterwards. What does it take to get back up and running quickly?
So in this case, it's really trying to get your crown jewels back up and running so that your company can get back up and running. For healthcare, that might be things such as EHR systems or other patient management systems, and then the systems that integrate into those. And that's why it's so important, and you'll hear quite often that you should have some kind of recovery plan in place before so that you're not spending valuable time trying to identify your crown jewels during an incident and instead can go ahead and continue recovery on those and get back up and running.
In order to prevent these from the very beginning, what are some best practices that organizations should know about to help shore up their resilience against a future breach?
Yeah, it really comes down to basic cyber hygiene in my mind. There's three things I would promote. One, staying up to date on patches. Two, backing up your critical systems and data and testing those backups to make sure they work. And then three, using multi-factor authentication to protect your privileged accounts and all remote access accounts as well, and check those to make sure that they're implemented properly. And those are just three. I'd say for more thorough guidelines, go check out on the Health and Human Services Cybersecurity Performance Goals or CPGs. Great resource, lots of good steps there. And then finally, I'd say, stay up to date on emerging threats and best practices and participate in your ISAC.
Thank you so much, all of you, for joining me. It was great speaking with you.
Thank you.
Now, after a breach affected hospitals in the San Diego, California area, the team at UC San Diego engaged in a community-driven approach to better their cybersecurity postures. I met up with the co-directors of the UC San Diego Center for Healthcare Cybersecurity, Dr. Christian Demeth and Dr. Jeff Tully, to talk about how security breaches affect patient outcomes, because ransomware attacks on hospitals aren't a question of if, but a matter of when.
At the UC Center for Healthcare Cybersecurity, we're a clinically oriented, evidence-based research center trying to understand how patients are impacted by ransomware attacks. There's lots of work being done on the technical side of it, but we know very little about how patients are impacted. For instance, how their care is delayed or their diagnoses are missed as a consequence of the technology infrastructure being down by things like ransomware.
You actually experienced sort of the fallout of a ransomware event when you were working in the ER. Can you tell us what that was like?
Yeah, I'll never forget it. I mean, there are times when I practice emergency medicine, events in my life where I'll never forget them, and this is one of them. I walk into the emergency department and I glance over and the waiting room's full of people. It's like 8 o'clock in the morning. It doesn't happen. Haven't you heard there's a ransomware attack in town and a bunch of hospitals are on diversion and all their patients are coming to us. So we didn't have beds available to put them in and I had none of their records. I couldn't look in the electronic health record and know what had happened to them or what medications they were on or what medical conditions they had. Healthcare is a very finite resource. There are only a certain number of hospitals. Some of those hospitals only take care of certain types of patients. They're specialized. And when a hospital's not available to take care of patients, whether it be a hurricane, an earthquake, or in this case, a ransomware attack, the ripple effect through the community can be huge. If the hospital closest to you is on diversion and the next one's 30 or 40 minutes away, well, it's gonna be 30 or 40 minutes before you get care. And that might make the difference in a condition like a heart attack or a stroke or something like severe sepsis. Hospitals are on downtime, not for an hour or two. They're on sometimes a month.
You were saying there's like ransomware for a cardiologist is different than a ransomware event for maybe someone who specializes in something else. Can you tell me a little bit more about that?
So one of the things we're doing at the center is trying to devise essentially a clinical ransomware playbook at the individual specialist level so that we can say, as a cardiology department, this is what you should care about with your patients that have heart transplants or your patients that have heart attacks. If you're a neurosurgeon, these are the things you should consider ransomware will do to your patient that has maybe, unfortunately, a large bleed in their brain or needs some type of neurosurgical intervention to survive. Ransomware impacts those patients differently. We really want to change it and allow a resource for these doctors and nurses to be able to break the glass and at least have something that can guide them to reduce the chance that their patients die or are severely injured as a consequence of the ransomware.
So Christian, you do a lot of cybersecurity research, specifically in healthcare, obviously. What do you think the state of that is? Where are we right now today?
In healthcare cybersecurity, we're very much in the leeches, mercury, and bloodletting phase, if you will, where we don't have data to help us make decisions. We don't know if you should completely disconnect all of your clinical systems when you've been ransomed and go to paper, or should you keep some of them operational to take care of patients, even though the infection might spread. We have no data to support what we should do. And I think that's one of the biggest reasons here at the Center for Healthcare Cybersecurity, we want to change that. We want to test whether or not certain interventions actually move the needle.
What can you do? And I think you have some really interesting answers around that.
One of the things we do in healthcare is we do simulation. We want to train our doctors and nurses on how to take care of very complex patients where minutes matter, not on real patients, but in a simulation.
I had the opportunity to visit UC San Diego's Simulation Center, where Dr. Jeff Tully trains individuals by replicating ransomware attack situations in a realistic hospital environment.
This is one of our three rooms that is set up to mimic a particular area of the hospital where we bring in medical students and nurses and resident doctors to train them how to deal with emergency situations in a safe and positive environment.
So you actually come here and have real practitioners, real doctors, operate as if they are under a ransomware event in the moment of giving patient care.
That's right. I'm actually scheduled to do one of these next week as part of our ongoing research program where we're going to be bringing in doctors and nurses and putting them into an ER type of situation where they're taking care of four different patients who have a variety of medical conditions. And unfortunately, the hospital they're at is affected by ransomware and they can't access their electronic health record. They can't send a patient to CT and have those results sent back to the doctor. They're having trouble transferring out patients, things like that. They wouldn't even think about ordinarily because we just take for granted our dependence on these types of technologies when caring for patients.
You recently did a study on the impact of these kinds of incidents and you found that it actually worsened the impacts of cardiac arrest.
We did take a look at some of that patient care data and saw that the chances that a patient who was suffering from an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, so their heart stopped in the field, EMS had to bring him into the hospital, their chances of having a favorable outcome where they left the hospital with good neurologic function, they went down by a factor of 10 in the setting of a ransomware attack. And what that really means is that we're just taking longer than we need to care for these patients in emergency conditions. And so that's the main patient care impact that we're worried about and hopefully can work to prevent.
Let's talk a little bit about what the impact of a ransomware event is, particularly on some hospitals that have less opportunity to do this training. It sounds like there's an impact not just to those rural hospitals, but also to the surrounding hospitals that may be a bit bigger.
If there are any surrounding hospitals, right? So some of these rural hospitals are the critical access points for a huge geographic region, where that's where people who are having strokes or in car accidents go to. And if these hospitals are affected, there really is an equity access to healthcare problem that can even worsen some of these disparities that we know already exist in the regional community. And even worse, we've seen a couple of examples of where hospitals have such a financial hit from these types of attacks that they're forced to close operations entirely. And if that's a hospital in one of these regional areas where there's not many other facilities, that can cause like healthcare deserts.
Hospitals and facilities may close because of ransomware events, leading to patient care disasters for those particular areas.
Absolutely. So it's not just the immediate impact from the ransomware. It's you lose a lot of your apparatus for billing and getting reimbursement for the care you're delivering. And healthcare runs on incredibly thin margins. So that can be existentially damaging for some of these hospitals. There are class action lawsuits from patients. There are large regulatory penalties. So there's multiple impacts from these types of attacks, in addition to obviously just the ransom itself.
To you, what does a really secure healthcare organization look like?
I think a secure healthcare organization is one that is aware of its own risk, right? Understands that this is a problem that you need to prepare for as much as you try to prevent it from happening. And really, as a clinician, as someone who takes care of patients, I think that the best way we can prepare for these types of events is to break down the silos that exist and to realize that ransomware is not just an IT problem, it is a patient care safety issue. And if we can bring down those barriers that exist between people like the IT security staff and your emergency managers who help you prepare for things like earthquakes and hurricanes and your doctors, you can all come together and say, okay, assuming that we lose some of these critical ways that we keep patients safe, what are our options? What are our backups? What are ways we can drill to prevent the worst outcomes from happening? Those are the hallmarks, I think, of a mature organization.
As security leaders, there's no better time than now to strengthen your security posture. Threats evolve, but so do our defenses, because the stakes are simply too high. For more details on the threat landscape facing the healthcare industry, including scenarios, guidance, and so much more, be sure to check out the Microsoft Threat Intelligence Healthcare Ransomware Report at aka.ms/MS Healthcare Report. I'm Sherrod DeGrippo. Thank you for joining me for a look at the healthcare threat landscape. For more of the latest threat intelligence, visit Microsoft Security Insider.